silence them. Our vision statement is all our students achieve success in college, career, and life. The thought for the day is from Mrs. Harding.
Impact. You never really know the true impact you have on those around you. You really never know how much someone needed that smile that you gave them. You never know how much your kindness turned someone else's life around. You never know how much someone needed that long hug or that deep talk. So don't wait to be kind. Don't wait for someone else to be kind first. Don't wait for a better circumstances or for someone to change. Just be kind, because you never know how much someone needs it. Nikki Vance.
Thank you. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Let the record reflect that all board members are in attendance. Now I'd like to ask for a moment of silence for personal reflection. Thank you. Do either Superintendent Browning or Attorney Alfonso have any comments about the COVID notice?
Madam Chairman, the Superintendent, and what I would like to do under this item is request that the board take an off-agenda item under, I think it would become 15-1, and I'm requesting to move the start time of the August 18th meeting from 6 p.m. to 9:30 a.m.
Did you have anything else you were going to say?
No, ma'am.
Okay,
that's it.
Thank you. Okay, so we will do a motion at that time to take an off-agenda item.
Well, Madam Chairman, we'll probably need to do it if you do the motion to
you
do an off-agenda.
You want me to take it now so that way people
so that people
speak
can
on
speak
it?
To okay. It. Yes, ma'am.
All right. Usually we do it later. Okay, so I need a motion to take an off-agenda item to change the meeting time for August 18th. A motion and a second.
So moved.
Second.
It's a motion by Altman, second by Armstrong. Any discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, motion carries. We're going to take that off agenda item at 15.1 to reschedule the meeting to the morning time. I need a motion to approve the minutes from July 28th.
So moved.
Second.
Crumbly, second by Armstrong. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. There are no public hearings or special presentations. So we're moving into public comment. Now is the time for the public to comment on agenda items only. Are there any green cards?
Yes, Madam Chair. We have received, I believe, 10 public comment requests. So if the board will allow, I will proceed with the announcement. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the opportunity for the public to be heard on items appearing for action on the meeting agenda. To speak at this time, you should already give in your name to staff in the lobby and filled out a speaking card. If you have any materials or documents you wish to share with the board, please either provide them today to the board secretary or follow up by emailing them to the board for distribution after the meeting. Each speaker will have 3 minutes during this segment, and I will serve as timekeeper. When you see the yellow flashing light on the podium, please wrap up your comments so that we'll leave time for the next speaker. Speakers will be called to come forward by the chair. Prior to making your remarks, please state your name and address for the record. All speakers and comments are subject to public to applicable school board policies regarding civility and decorum. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Okay, these were numbered. So first we're gonna have Patrick Connolly, followed by Christine Anderson, and then Jeremy Blythe. Mr. Connolly.
Can everybody hear me fine?
Yes.
Okay. I'm still Pat Connolly. I still live at 55417 Mew Drive, Zephyr Hills, Florida. Actually, I have two agenda items to address right now, 10.3 and 15.3, whatever it was that Mr. Browning suggested. First of all, that one. I believe it is a tragic mistake to change the time of our next meeting to a time when teachers and the public are less likely to be able to attend. I appreciate a vote of no on that resolution. I appreciate the bind this board finds itself in. Trying to work out a solution to this problem which satisfies as many people's concerns while keeping our community as safe as possible is a daunting task. There are no perfect solutions. The only perfect solution would be a time machine to go back and keep any of this from happening. The only safe solution is starting all schools online, applying the lessons we learned from last spring. But neither of those seems to be possible, given the unlikelihood of time travel right now, and the political pressure to provide daycare services to our students. So you must come up with a solution, recognizing that it cannot be perfect and will not be as safe as it should be. In the way we open right now, what will happen? If staff applies a self-screener with fidelity, there will not be enough staff to safely operate the school. If parents apply their screener with fidelity, there will not be enough space and allocated online resources to accommodate the students who must stay home. If we don't apply these screeners with fidelity, we will have this virus running rampant through our schools and our community. A statistical study published in the New York Times projects that every full-size high school in this county will have at least 8 COVID-positive people attend during the first week, and at least 4 in every elementary school. The district keeps saying our hands are tied by Tallahassee, while Tallahassee ignores the reality of life where our people live. Today I have good news. Excuse me. Duval has loosened those shackles at least a little bit. They are in phase 2 as we are, and their reopening plan did not include opening all their schools brick and mortar. Yet that was approved by the Florida Department of Education. I won't go through their plan. You can read it in the paper. This seems to be the best and safest compromise, and we should consider it. I've already shared in one of my many emails a basic plan for our secondary schools as learning centers for those students who need to attend in person, and I will not take the board's time repeating that idea now. Thank you very much.
Thank you
for your comments.
Christine Anderson. Christine Anderson, 8621 Hawbuck Street, Trinity, Florida, 34655. I'm here to talk about the agenda item that we are regarding the moving of the work schedule. I believe that this is the wrong conversation for you all to be having today. When we closed our schools in March, our positivity rate in Pasco County was between 4.5 and 5%. It was determined that reopening schools for brick and mortar instruction posed too great a risk for our community. But here we are in August with a 10% positivity rate, and you expect us to believe that there is minimal risk associated with returning to traditional face-to-face instruction. This past week, the CDC Director Robert Redfield stated that schools in areas with a 5% positivity rate or higher need to use distance learning. This past Sunday, Dr. Deborah Birx, the White House Coronavirus Response Coordinator, made the same recommendation, indicating that coronavirus outbreaks need to be under control in communities before schools can safely reopen. Here in Pasco County, the plan to return to brick and mortar instruction ignores the recommendations of our nation's top public health officials. The superintendent and you, the members of the school board, continue to argue that the executive order ties your hands when it comes to online-only start to the school year. However, this past week, attorneys for the Florida Department of Education wrote to the school board of Orange County declaring that the day-to-day decision to open or close a school must always rest locally with the board. Additionally, the FDOE signed off on Monroe County's plan to start the school year virtually for the first 30 days. Miami-Dade was approved for a 100% online start to the school year. The Department of Education also approved Duval's plan for secondary students to begin the school year online. The Sarasota County School Board is meeting today to explore the possibility of an online-only return to learn for students. It's quite clear from examples around the state that your hands are not tied. As school board members, you have the legal authority to make this decision. You also have the moral responsibility to safeguard our health and safety. With our current rate of infection in Pasco County, no amount of safety precautions can keep students and staff safe. Social distancing is impossible in our schools and even more so on the school buses. Here in this room, the spacing and occupancy regulations are not even possible in most of our classrooms across Pasco County and certainly not on our school buses. During our pre-planning week, our school is going to host a faculty meeting via Zoom where we participate via our individual classrooms. If these measures are needed to protect people during the school board and pre-planning week,
then it is not safe for us to return to brick-and-mortar instruction at this time. I urge the school board to do more than express your sympathies and hide behind an executive order. As a teacher and a resident of Pasco County, I charge each of you with the difficult task of doing what is right rather than what is politically expedient. Tell DeSantis and Corcoran that school buildings should not reopen until there is a 14-day downward trend and a positivity rate below 5%. Take a stand and protect us, because even one student or staff death is one too many. Thank you.
Thank you. Jeremy Blythe and then Allie Heyman.
Superintendent Browning, Chairwoman Bodwin, and members of the school board, my name is Jeremy Blythe.
Excuse me. Oh, sorry. You're saying it now. Name and address for the record.
Oh, I'm sorry. Jeremy Blythe, 5521 Pentale Circle, Tampa, Florida, 33625.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Superintendent Browning, Chairwoman Bodwin, and members of the school board, my name is Jeremy Blythe, and I'm a teacher here in Pasco County. This is the start of my fifth year with Pasco County Schools, and I wish that I could stand before you today and tell you that I was excited. I wish I could tell you that I was looking forward to getting back into the classroom with my students and meeting a bunch of smiling new faces ready to tackle a new school year. Instead, I'm afraid, I'm angry, and I'm sad. Being a teacher has prepared me to do many things, but what I cannot prepare for is the idea that I will have to bury a colleague or a student. I don't want my family to have to bury me either this year if we head back to campus before it is safe. I don't want to stand here and talk about statistics or what age has the most communicability. You know all of this. You have the information, you have the details, you have the tools to stand up and do what's right. I know that I can speak on behalf of at least 4,500 members of the Pasco for Safe Return to Campus community group when I say we are not in a position where we should be opening schools for face-to-face instruction. The time is not right, and we need to do anything that we can do to ensure that our students and staff are safe to return to campus without impending health problems. Now is simply not that time. We want to be back with our students in the classroom more than most appear to realize. We know the best atmosphere and situation is for our kids to be in class, learning in the environments that we so painstakingly create for them to learn to their best abilities. What we also know is that we are almost certainly putting them in harm's way to do so. We are putting our teachers at risk, these teachers who work countless hours off the clock to ensure that their kids are achieving their greatest success, even when most are at risk. We would never ask students or staff to return to campus if there were an imminent health threat that you could actually see on campus, such as an active shooter. We would protect them at all costs, but with COVID-19, we are saying no, you need to be here regardless of that danger. The thing is that COVID-19's transmission may not be visible, but its physical and mental effects certainly are. We must put our children's lives first, not politics, not money, not power. I do not envy any single one of you sitting here today faced with the decisions you are faced with. I do understand that these are impossibly difficult decisions that require much effort and sleepless nights. I call on you, our decision makers, to do the right thing and reach out to the governor and education commissioner, tell them that you will not put your students or staff in harm's way and be withheld funding. We are creative, we are resilient, and we are innovative. In cities across the country, they are devising well-thought-out plans for how they will return in the fall, but while doing so safely. A school district in Colorado will be doing all virtual while offering small on-site pods of students for other essential employees who cannot monitor their children while distance learning. It can be done, we will get through this, but what will be the story that we tell on the other side? Will your books have memorials plastered throughout to commemorate the staff and students that have perished because we chose politics and money over the value of life? I thank you for your time today, and I assure you this one thing. I stand with you, I stand with Pasco County Schools. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Allie Heyman and then Rachel Miller.
Good morning.
My name is Allie. Name address for the record, please.
You can lower it if you want to.
She's getting there.
Is that good?
Better.
Thank you.
Hi, good morning. My name is Allie Heyman, 3011 Polar Trail, Odessa. So I want you to please consider learning to begin on October 24th. I'm a teacher and a parent of a Pasco student. I'm also a caretaker to my elderly parents. Distant learning in the classrooms is not possible. Safe social distancing in the classroom is also not possible. Yesterday I went into my school. I tried to set up just to alleviate any anxiety I had about the desks and the chairs. I typically have between 35 and 37 students in my classroom at a high school. It was physically impossible to have chairs, even without desks, within 6 feet of social distancing. I'm concerned. I also don't want to keep myself in a complete bubble, but I'm going to need to. I'd like you to please consider 100% virtual on August 24th. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you for your comments. Rachel Miller and then Amy Monroe.
Hello.
Hello.
Good morning.
My name's Rachel Miller. My address is exempt because my partner is, okay.
Thank you.
Teachers understand that it's impossible to guarantee our safety and that of our students. We understand that accidents happen. We understand that severe weather occurs, a fire might happen, and school shootings are an unfortunate part of American society. We also know how to deal with these scary situations because we train for them. Active shooter drills, severe weather drills, fire drills, AED drills. Our board has done nothing to train us for this. There are no drills, there are no procedures, and there is nothing but empty assurances coming from our leaders. Our superintendent said that it is likely that our students will have COVID-19 in our classrooms. The New York Times agrees with Mr. Browning, projecting 8 students will have contracted coronavirus in Pasco County during the first week of attendance in a school with a capacity of 1,000 people. When asked about what to do in a situation with a student who tests positive or exhibits symptoms or is around a student who exhibits symptoms or any symptom or any other likely possibility, our superintendent said that was granular information that would be worked out as we go. We were also told that many of these decisions would be made by principals at individual school sites. It's your job to provide students with a safe environment to learn and your employees a safe environment to work in, and you've abdicated your responsibility to both. The district is not prepared. However, like just about every other teacher, I've come prepared today with information. The Florida chapter of the American Academy of Pediatrics has stated in their July 16th letter to Governor DeSantis that public health experts and infectious disease physicians almost universally recommend that children not go to schools until the positivity test rate is 3-5% over a rolling 2-week average. If children go to school with such high infection rates, schools will be forced to close very quickly after opening, and many children and families will likely become ill with SARS-CoV-2. In other parts of the world where schools have successfully opened, the infection rates from SARS-CoV-2 were much lower than here in Florida. Additionally, in the FCAAP's July 28th recommendations regarding school reopening, they state that at the time of this writing, viral positivity rates are extremely high in Florida. The World Health Organization has recommended that the new positive test rate should be less than 5% averaged over a 14-day period before schools can safely open. Therefore, the FCAAP recommends that school districts and locales with higher positive test rates, greater than 5%, that do not meet the 14-day criteria, delay the start date for school until positive testing rates are lower. In many areas of the state, coronavirus prevalence will not decrease enough in the next 4 to 6 weeks to make the benefits of school attendance outweigh the risks. For the record, the positivity rate for Pasco County has not fallen below 7% for roughly 6 weeks, and it's currently sitting at 8.4%. Sorry. The list of reasons not to reopen brick-and-mortar schools is longer than my 3 minutes will allow. The simple solution to this impossible situation is to start school virtually for at least the first quarter of the year. Teachers are prepared for distance learning. We did it successfully last year, and we're praised by the board and the superintendent for doing it. And like everything else you ask us to do, we can make that happen on a moment's notice, too. Thank you.
Thank you. Amy Monroe and then Alexis Parker.
Hi, Amy Monroe, 23267 Chelsea Loop, Land O'Lakes. I'm here as a representative for our Wiregrass staff. I have many notes. I don't want to completely go through all of them with you as they've been stated before. But they just want to remind the board that we've got a staff shortage as it is. If we have to go out for 10 days, it's not just one teacher. One student in the high school hits 6 teachers. We don't have 6 subs. We're covering each other's classes as it is last year, and we can't afford to do this. I feel, from what I've seen in my classes, especially at the secondary level, that our district and our curriculum development have done a wonderful job developing these classes to go online. I know as a teacher, when I stand in front of those kids, if I have to go back brick and mortar, it's not gonna look pretty. I'm gonna be standing in front of them separated out, not even being able to move or speak. I was in a classroom back in July for an ACT testing that I proctored. My students couldn't even sit as far apart as you are now taking a test. I feel that we need to go online. I have many other teachers just wanting to say that we have a class of sizes of about 30, 32, and 34 right now at Wiregrass Ranch High School. We are not sitting at 25 kids in our classroom. I have seniors who are big kids. Sitting 3 feet apart is almost touching. And another thing that we would like to address is the air conditioning situation at our school. It's hot, and with all of this face protection, we would like to possibly get that addressed as well. As a parent, I have a student who is going to be entering first grade at Pineview Elementary School. I am not comfortable sending my kid back to school in these forms. He said to me today when I was on my way to school, or on my way here to this board meeting, "Mommy, I want to go back to school, but I don't want to go back with a mask and where I can't hug my friends and hug my teacher and sit at circle time and read." That hurts me more than anything. I want to be able to talk to my kids and see them and have a rapport with them, and I cannot do that in this way. Please consider online for the first quarter. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Alexis Parker and then Beth Robinson.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, please.
Okay.
Name and address for the record.
Alexis Parker, 9013 Pebble Creek Drive, Tampa, Florida, 33647.
Thank you.
I teach pre-K SBC, so little 3 and 4 year olds with autism, or may have not been diagnosed, but they will be diagnosed soon with autism. I know it's going to be impossible for me to follow CDC guidelines in my classroom because my students are 3 and 4 years old with autism. They're nonverbal, toilet training issues, all that kind of stuff. I'm a single mother of this little wonderful boy here who's going to be starting your inclusion DPK class this year, hopefully. I have no family to watch my son if I were to get sick. My father died when I was 3 and my mother died when I was 4, which is my son's age. I was lucky enough to have my grandmother to raise me. My son does not have the same fortune. Because I'm a single mother, my only source of income is my salary from teaching at Pasco. I requested to teach my school online. On July 14th, I received an email stating that there was not a need for my school to provide an online teacher for pre-K. It said I could submit ADA paperwork or take a leave of absence. I don't have any disabilities that would warrant an ADA accommodation. My only other option is either to stay safe and take a leave of absence. I feel like I've been giving Sophie's choice. I can go back to teaching in a classroom where I'm sure to get sick and possibly die because it's impossible to follow CDC guidelines in my classroom with fidelity, or I can take a leave of absence and be homeless in 2 months, 3 months tops. I'm imploring the school board to please start the year virtually. I do not want to have to choose between death or homelessness.
Thank you for your
comments. Beth Robinson, and then Lisa Spencer-Nova.
Good morning. Thank you for this opportunity. I guess it all comes down to, for me, is it life or is it the economy that is our priority here? You know, we know the statistics. We know the information that's out there. We've all heard it. And that's where it comes down to for me. I'm worried once the children get on the buses that they're entering a petri dish of infection. I worry when they walk into their classrooms. I worry about for the students, I worry for the teachers, the SRPs, the bus drivers, and myself. But it's not just about me. So I urge you to please consider that you can make the decision to save lives here. Thank you.
Thank
Wait
you.
One you second.
Your name and address for the record, please.
We're both.
Oh, I'm sorry. Beth Robinson, and my address is 18546 Avocet Drive.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Lisa Spencer-Novak, and then Cynthia Thompson. Good morning. Name and address for the record, please.
Lisa Spencer-Novak, 7912 Trail Run Loop, Newport Richey, 34653.
Thank you.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I realize my time is short. I'm not going to repeat what everybody has already told you about statistics, about the dangers. Let me just say I concur with all of the above and leave it at that. I would like to speak to you about what it means to be an educator. I came to education later in life. It was not my first career. And I was inspired to do it. I was not inspired to lie to children and tell them, don't believe in science. Don't believe in what the facts are showing you. I feel that we have a moral responsibility as educators to teach kids that science is real. Education matters. It's not our job to open the economy. The teachers are increasingly in public school being asked to cover society's ills. We have shootings. Well, don't do anything about that. Just make teachers take mental health classes. We're not supposed to be everybody's fix-it. And that includes opening the economy. We are teachers. We are educators. We are here because that's our passion. Nobody goes into this for the fame or the fortune. Trust me. We don't want to stay home. We're not lazy. We don't not love our kids. That's all not true. We are completely dedicated to what we do or we wouldn't be here. But it is not fair to put the burden of this on us or on our students or on their families. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments.
Thank you for your comments. Cynthia Thompson, and that's the last one. Good morning.
Good morning. My name is Cynthia Thompson. My address is 13227 Meadow Gulf Ave, Hudson, Florida. You've heard a lot of people tell you the stats, the rules, the laws, all that stuff so far. I cried this week when I had to change my daughter to my school online. She's a kindergartner. And it breaks my heart to know she's not going to have that in-school experience. I was going to send her to Moon Lake Elementary, but how could I live with myself if my daughter dies, if my daughter gets sick and passes it to my family members, my elderly grandmother, my mother and my father, my mother-in-law, how could I live with myself? And we're asking all these teachers to go back on the schedule and live with themselves, knowing that they don't have a choice. We need to go online. We need to go online for the first quarter, and then we can look at it week by week with the numbers. I guess my biggest concern is I have to deal with students who have emotional issues and have family issues, and their family members have died, so I know what it's like to comfort a child when their mom or dad have died. So what are we going to do when we have to tell them that, sorry, mommy went to work at the school, she spread the disease or a student or virus, and somebody or the student gave her the virus, it spread around the school. How many people have to die? How many students, how many staff members need to die before we go online? I think that's the real question you need to answer with the calendar stuff, is what's that number? When are we going to, we're going to end up shifting to online because it's going to spread like wildfire. But obviously this way, people are going to have to die first. And as far as changing the agenda, meeting for the time to 9:30, that's a teacher work day. And that would take a lot of people, not just parents, students, and teachers. They wouldn't be able to come to the meeting. They wouldn't be able to have their voice heard. This isn't being live streamed. This is being loaded up on YouTube afterwards, which is great, but at least with the live stream, we knew what was going on, and we had the opportunity to use the phone to make comments. Bottom line is, my child's life is more important to me. Are you guys, do you guys feel your staff members and your children and these students, are their lives important to you? And that's all I have to say.
Thank you for your comments. Youssef, Mr. Peace, would you like to speak?
Madam Chair, if I may, just for the record, I would note, and it's kind of in response, that the board has continued to accept public comment or input by written comment prior to the meeting. And I wanted to note there is not anyone who has otherwise submitted an agenda item comment card for today. There will be at least some discussion of a written public comment that was received on a non-agenda item that I'll address later. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Peace?
Superintendent Browning, Attorney Alfonso, Chair Baldwin, honorable board members and district staff, good morning. I was informed yesterday that Mr. Shibley and his wife experienced the birth of a new baby. We would like to extend our congratulations to the family and hope that everyone stays healthy. As I informed all of you a couple of weeks ago, USEP, through its rep council, is advocating for an all-virtual reopening of schools. You may have seen some press coverage this past weekend as the message gets put out. There were a number of employees and parents outside this morning advocating for that position as well. USEP's executive board voted to file an injunction against the emergency order in an attempt to open virtually. Let me be clear in the message. We are not saying we don't want to return to brick and mortar. We are saying we don't want to return to brick and mortar now. Pediatricians and the CDC are saying that we should not be heading back to schools at this time. When the positivity rate shows a downward trend and is below 5%, which is the level that ironically triggered a stay-at-home order back in April, then and only then would it be prudent to have a conversation on returning in a face-to-face format. If the data supports reopening following the CDC recommendations, then reopen. However, if the data does not support this decision, the only way to not put lives in jeopardy is to open online. We want to teach our students. We understand their needs and want to deliver critical services. However, we want to do this in a manner that does not put students or employees at risk. We have the means to use technology in order to save lives. This is something that I would urge you to consider. On another note, we hope to start the bargaining conversation related to employee salaries next week. Due to recent legislation, it may prove to be quite a challenge to represent everyone fairly when there are strings attached to the funding dollars. We look forward to working with the district to do the best we can financially for all employees. As always, we will continue to work to make Pasco the best educational opportunity we can for all of our students and all of our employees. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Peace. It's time for board member committee reports. In a little different order. Mrs. Crumbly, do you have any committee reports?
No, I had no committees meet.
Thank you. Mrs. Harding?
I had none.
Mr. Altman?
Value Adjustment Board met last Thursday and went through everything just as normal. There's really nothing new to report or different, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Mrs. Armstrong?
No meetings.
And I had no meetings either. Superintendent Browning, do you have any comments?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, Madam Chairman. Members, I just want to provide just a take a moment, if I can, to once again let the teachers that have come to the podium this morning to address the board, and I know that we've all received emails, possibly phone calls, appearances before this board, and I will tell you, I've said this over and over again, that we are between that proverbial rock and a hard place where we find ourselves with that emergency order. I know there's been some comments made this morning about what Orange County has done. I think it needs to be clarified that Orange County, in fact, has voted and decided to go virtual from August 10th to August 20th for 2 weeks. And then by virtue of the emergency order, they're required to go to bricks and mortar. So I still scratch my head saying, what does that 2 weeks virtual get you? But that's what they've done. They have not, they may have voted to start the school year virtually, but they are, before the month ends, going to be back in bricks and mortar. I also want to remind you that the comment was made about Miami-Dade going 100% virtual. Miami-Dade, Broward, and Palm Beach counties are under phase one of the governor's reopening order. They have that latitude, they have that flexibility. Pasco does not. We are in phase two. There's been a lot of discussion out there and comments made about funding. And the fact remains that when you read the emergency order, it is very clear that funding is tied to the fact that school districts need to open with bricks and mortar. You have to truly connect the dots. But if you want funding and you want to be held harmless from funding reductions, then the expectation is that districts will open bricks and mortar. If we do not get funding from the state, our teachers do not get paid. Our bus drivers do not get paid. Staff in general does not get paid. It's going to be tough to keep lights on. So we are in that, between that rock and hard place. I understand. I have read every email that's come to my inbox from teachers and parents about the concerns and the fears that that we have about reopening school. I want to reassure the board again that we are doing everything that we can to ensure the safety of our staff and of our students. We're not going to prevent it, but we are in the business of trying to minimize the impacts or the spread of COVID. It is something that I've said this over and over again as well. It's fluid. We change, we adapt, staff has worked tirelessly to ensure that our schools are ready to go. I think it's also important to note that even after all the news reports, the data that's out there, we still have currently today 66% of our families that are wanting to return bricks and mortar. And by virtue of that, we need to be able to staff and provide that for them. It's also important to note that we have teachers out there that are also not here today, but we have teachers out there because I had the emails in my inboxes and the personal visits in the produce section of Publix when they stopped me saying, I want to come back. I want to come back. I want to be with my kids. Listen, I don't doubt for 1 minute that the teachers that appeared before us today that have concerns don't want to be back. Absolutely, I know they want to be back. Who doesn't want to be back in a normal classroom setting? But we also have teachers out there that right now don't share those same concerns. They're ready to come back. And we've got to ensure that our bricks and mortar schools are staffed, as well as My School Online and our Pasco eSchool option. So I just wanted to provide those clarifications. We continue. I've had direct conversations with the commissioner. I've had direct conversations with the chancellor about the provisions of the executive order, and they were patently clear what the intent of the order was. That being said, I'm going to shift gears just a quick minute, and I'm going to yield some of my time to Mr. Wicks. I know that board members have been hearing a lot about athletics in the district, and I wanted to give a little bit of my time this morning to Mr. Wicks to come on forward. So, Mr. Wicks, if you'll come up, give you an update, a brief update on where we are with athletics in the Pasco District and the Florida High School Athletic Association.
Superintendent Browning, can I ask a quick question before we transition?
Yeah.
Because I know that you said that, you know, approximately two-thirds of our families still have requested brick and mortar. And in the last data I got, I want to clarify for the public because people are saying that that's counting the default. And that's not counting the default. That's of the people who responded, correct? Because I've gotten that information from...
It is not. That is correct.
All right. Okay, because I got that information from Mr. Haggerty, but I just wanted to make sure that I said that publicly because I think some people are under the impression that 60-some percent is counting the people who defaulted into bricks and mortar because they didn't respond. It's 67% or 60-something percent that actually chose bricks and mortar.
That 66-plus percent have affirmatively chosen to return to bricks and mortar. Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to make sure we clarify that. Thank you. Sorry, Mr. Wicks.
Oh, no, you're
now right. We can switch gears.
Healthy discussion in these crazy times. Just wanted to give you all, first of all, thank you guys for having me. Good to see everyone. Hope everyone is well. So if not everyone's aware, the FHA was slated to start athletics on July 27th. They did have a couple of interesting board meetings, to say the least, and then they pushed that date back to now August 24th is the tentative date. There is another board meeting on August 14th to decide what that fall sports calendar will look like. There are three options out there that are being discussed. They are not official options, but they are options that have been recommended that are, well, are getting feedback. We have committee meetings for every sport in the state. So there's large committees. So all those committees are seeing those options and basically going to give feedback to the board of directors on that. They're also asking county athletic directors to provide feedback and what our current plan is. So I just wanted to give you a little bit of update on that. As of right now, our start for athletics was moved to September 7th, which is Monday, September 7th. It's a holiday. But that week basically would be our first week. And we did that in order to see what kind of give ourselves 2 weeks within school and then start sports. And I felt like that was kind of the norm. We kind of got together as a group of counties, myself, Hillsborough, Pinellas, Polk County, Osceola, Orange, Manatee, Sarasota. All of these county athletic directors have been meeting regularly to talk about different ideas and how we can move forward with safe athletics. Because we do feel it's important not to cancel our sports, but we do feel it's important to return to sports safely. So we've been developing guidelines. We've been in our schools since July 1st doing summer activities. And we've been doing temperature checks and screenings on a daily basis with our athletes. And we've had a lot of success. So we've had kids come back with symptoms, and we've sent them home. And they've been able to return with doctor's clearance. So we've been able to do some of that stuff, which is nice. It has been very successful. We are working in pods of 30 kids at a time. And we are allowing those kids to come on campus and exercise, get in the weight room, do those things. We've implemented cleaning procedures, all those things around having our kids on campus. We will continue to do that. We're developing guidance for schools when we do go back to athletics about how to use locker rooms safely for athletics and how to do things. The FHA has put out some information on how to, some what they will call recommendations on how to, referees are going to have to wear masks. Students are going to have to wear masks on the bench. Things like that. While they're participating in the actual event of the game, they are not going to be required to wear masks at this time. So those are little things that the FHA has put out. It has slowly come out, I can tell you that. We have been meeting with the FHA for months asking for this guidance, and it's kind of been like pulling teeth, I guess you'd call it. So we finally got some, but not everything. So we're hoping for some more guidance come the 14th. To see what that fall calendar looks like. One of the things we're looking at right now, if we start September 7th, there's a possibility that some of our teams may not play in the state series just because it doesn't line up. We don't want that to happen, but again, we're about making, we want it to be safe for our kids, right? People have referenced Miami-Dade. They're not even allowing their kids to come on campus right now to even do anything. Workouts, conditioning, nothing. People can't even go back in their buildings. So a lot of their schools right now, they're pushing for a winter or spring flip of some of those sports. So we haven't gotten that information yet. Right now, the information from the FHA is we're going to let the school districts decide. So that seems to be the theme. So again, people, I don't envy anybody in these situations, but we have to make decisions, we have to make protocols, and we have to move forward. And that's what we've done. So we're going to continue to do that. We're going to continue to make protocols that it's safe for our kids to come back and return to sports because, in our opinion, we feel it's healthy. We feel it's healthy mentally for our kids to come back and participate. Listen, our kids are out in AAU tournaments. Our kids are participating in softball tournaments. Our kids are participating in swim meets everywhere. We've had kids on AAU teams go and play in tournaments in Orlando where there's 70 teams, and they have protocols. And they go through things, and they haven't had many issues. Obviously, with that many kids, there are issues. I don't know all the AAU issues. That's a whole other ball of wax. But I can tell you that they have done stuff safely. So we look at those things. We also look at the Major League Baseball. We look at the NFL. We look at some of these colleges that are developing return-to-play protocols, and we look at those, and we take those into account for our own use and to see how safely it's done. So there are some organizations out there leading the path. So we keep reevaluating. As we all know, this situation changes almost daily, especially with the FHA. It's changed, hourly. So I hope to have more guidance on the 14th, and then I can come back and give you an update if needed. Any questions?
Mr. Wicks, is
yes,
it
sir.
All fall sports?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. This time it's all fall sports.
Mm-hmm. But you are correct.
And middle school, too. Yeah. High school and middle school.
Okay. Yeah. The kids are out playing and...
They are. They are. And you know, like I said, we've done it safely, and we can still have practices safely. We just haven't gone down that route yet. It's we're continuing our summer activities like we're allowed to. And then, my staff and a group of people and some of our athletic trainers, we're developing some guidelines for like kind of like that next phase once we start school. All right.
Thank you, Mr. Wicks.
Absolutely. My pleasure.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
That's all I have, Madam Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Gadd.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I just wanted to share briefly that the superintendent had a meeting with all of the principals. What was that, 3 weeks ago? Yeah, about 3 weeks ago. And we social distanced and wore a mask and went to River Ridge Middle School, High School Performing Arts Center. And it was a great meeting. It was unique and different because everybody came in with masks. Everybody left with masks, and everybody was very quiet. In fact, usually when you get a crowd of principals in a room like that, you have to scream and holler at them for them to shut up before the superintendent can speak. And he was able to just kind of launch into what he was talking about, and everybody quietly sat there and left. One of the problems with a meeting like that is you can't get a real sense for how people feel because of the COVID-19 situation, so everybody came in and left. I have since called just about every principal. I started last week. I think I have 10 more to go, as my assistant will attest. It's been challenging because I will call them, they're not available, and four or five of them will call back at the same time. But she has listened to me talk to every one of them, and I've taken notes from every principal I've spoken to. And I wanted this board to know that our administrators are prepared. They are ready to go. They know what the challenges are ahead of them. They appreciated the meeting at River Ridge, felt like the superintendent and the staff was honest with them and candid with them about what we're facing. And also the superintendent shared with them at that meeting, and it was well received, that we're all in this together, that we have to take care of each other, do the very best that we can. In my conversations with the principals, I talked to them. First of all, the first question I asked them, it may sound a little strange, but I say, how are you feeling about starting the school year? Because I really do want to know what, not what they're thinking, but how they're feeling about starting the school year. And I can tell you that every principal has said to me that they have concerns, they're a little bit anxious, but they're ready to go. They think their staffs are ready to go. They think their schools are ready to go. I've talked to them about their staffing, and every principal has said to me they feel pretty good about their staffing. There are a couple of schools that, you know, have some key individuals that they're working on. Every school just about has a couple of people that have taken the ADA option. But most of the schools that I've talked to have said they've been able to provide the MSLO option to most of the people that wanted it. Of course, at the secondary level, that's a little bit more of a struggle, but they feel good about their staffings. Most of our schools are pretty well staffed up and doing great at hiring some of the new positions that they need. I've talked to all the schools about the cohorts, especially in the elementary level. And at the elementary level, kind of the Achilles heel of the cohort are lunchrooms. And every school is making arrangements to work their lunch program differently. When you have schools with 30% of the kids on MSOL, it makes crowding in the lunchroom less of a problem. Some of the schools even have teachers that have volunteered to spend lunch in the classroom with the kids. Shady Hills, for example, Mr. Barker put out a survey, and about half of the teachers there said, we're happy to eat lunch with our children in the classroom, and then they're covering the other classrooms, so they're not even going to use lunchrooms unless they have to. Other schools are finding alternative spaces for the lunchroom, covered play areas, art rooms, music rooms, things of that sort. So we have had lengthy discussions about the cohorts. We've talked about staffing, we've talked about the school days, we've talked about drop-off and pick-up. And I'm really proud of our principals. I was telling the assistant superintendents who have more contact with them than I do that they are doing a stellar job of getting our schools ready for the start of the year. And I feel confident that they're all prepared and they're up to the challenge. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gadd. And I assume Mr. Shibley's with his family. Congratulations to the Shibley family. Mrs. Coon.
Good morning, Honorable Board Members, Attorney Alfonso. I have a few things for you this morning. I'd like to first start with an introduction. You may recall that on July 7th, we brought a recommendation for the hiring of Mike Baumeister as our Chief of Safety and Emergency Operations. He has started with us and is here today with his wife, Chrissy. They're seated right here. So I'd like to stand and recognize. And I'd like to tell you a little bit about his resume because he has quite a lot of experience and we're very, very excited to have him starting with us. He started his career in law enforcement with the Sheriff's Office as a corrections deputy in 1991 and stayed there for 5 years. When I say Sheriff's Office, I meant Pasco Sheriff's Office. He then went to Tampa PD where he has served at every level with distinction. He's been a commander of internal affairs, criminal intelligence, special operations, became a major and served with support services in District 2 in North Tampa. He recently retired as a major as District 2 Patrol. He knows Steve Hagerty. We don't hold that against him. We thank Steve for bringing him to us. Mike is married to Chrissy, who's here with him today. Chrissy is the LDC at River Ridge Middle School. And Mike and Chrissy both graduated from Pasco County Schools, and they have a son who is a River Ridge graduate, a daughter currently attending River Ridge. Lieutenant Ferguson, Melissa Musselwhite, and I interviewed for this position, and all three of us just immediately were just taken by Mike and his commitment to safety of our schools and also to Pasco County and Pasco County Schools. We're very fortunate that he's joining our team and look forward to you meeting with him and working with him as well. So I wanted to bring that to your attention. Welcome, Mike.
Thank you. Congratulations, Mike. Thank you.
So a couple other items for you this morning. One is item 11.1. I wanted to share some information on that. That is the consolidation of the after-school enrichment programs and PLACE programs. And I can certainly answer any questions, but just wanted to give you a little information on that as well. And that is, there are 11 programs that we are proposing to consolidate. And this is certainly not something that Mary Gray and her team want to do, but it is necessary for the financial viability of the program. After-school enrichment programs in place did not bring in any revenue from March 13th to June 15th when they reopened, and the summer revenue has been down significantly. Our goal will be to bring back programs if enrollment returns, but at this point, that is our recommendation for the financial viability of the program. Additionally, although this is a very difficult time for this program, PLACE is celebrating its 30th anniversary as a school board program this summer, starting with 5 schools and 726 students and eventually growing to 36 elementary schools, 4 middle schools, 6 grant programs. Mary Gray, who is here today, started in 1990. She was 10 with the PLACE program, and she's been with the program for most of the time that it's been around. I'm confident that PLACE will rebound and will continue to be a successful program as they have been. I'm grateful to Mary and her team for their leadership through good times and bad. So just wanted to share that with you. Additionally, as Mr. Shibley is out with his newborn son and his wife, I wanted to bring addendum 10.1 personal recommendations to you as usual, that is an addendum. And then also addendum 10.2 for the revised work calendars. Calendar 490 showed October 12th as a training day, but it is a non-work day. So just wanted to point that out to you as an addendum item. And then finally, we have some welcome back meetings for transportation next week. We have August 12th and August 14th. We will welcome back our bus drivers, and I'm looking forward to that. It'll be a much different setting than usual, but we are looking forward to welcoming them back and talking with them about all of the changes this school year. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Coon. Dr. Moore?
Good morning, Honorable School Board Member, Superintendent Browning, Attorney Fonzo. It's my pleasure and honor to share a couple of highlights again and updates from the Career, Technical, and Adult Education Department. So first, I'd like to start off with congratulating the class of 2020 from Marchman Technical College. We had their graduation last Wednesday, and I had the privilege of attending. and it was just a wonderful opportunity to celebrate the hard work and commitment of our students and their success in completing their workforce programs. Speaking of Marchmen, I just want to let you know that they've also been continuing with testing over the summer. The Assessment Center has been reopened and was open since May 26 following CDC guidelines. So we're testing no more than 8 students at a time. But in the past 8 weeks, 309 GED exams have been given, 103 TABE tests, which is for our adult basic education, and 229 certification tests have been administered. And those tests include, the certification tests include our American Health Information Management Association, the Amazon Web Services, our insurance comp TIA, pharmacy technician certification, and Federal Secret Service. So just a few certifications that we've been doing at Marchmen. Speaking of industry certifications, our staff is organizing boot camps to support our teachers and students upon their return to school. Boot camps will allow students who were unable to complete their industry certification testing during the 2019-20 school year to receive a refresher and, when ready, complete their industry certification exam. So that's important for our students to be able to successfully do that in spite of the challenges that we had with fourth quarter. And I'm also very, very excited to share with you our CTE teacher welcome back. So our district CTE team will be kicking off the 2021 school year with Welcome Back Virtual Professional Development Session. The theme this year, as I've been telling you along, is it's a whole new ball game. The day will start with sharing our goals and plans for career and technical education in Pasco County. Our superintendent will also be Zooming in to provide a welcome message to our teachers and staff. And we will be leading sessions that will provide a game plan for our new way of work and purpose behind CTE due to the changes in Perkins 5 funding, which has made significant requirements or placed significant requirements upon us to do. In the afternoon, teachers will meet in professional learning community groups to share strategies and map out their plans for the coming school year. And we would like to thank Pasco County Education Foundation and Horace Mann for their generous donations in support of this event. So you have all been presented with this wonderful bag with some goodies inside of it. But the most important thing I want you to hold on to is your ticket, because this ticket will admit you into our event that day. It has the link on there for you to Zoom in, and we hope that you'll join us for part of the day and that you'll enjoy your goodies. We are excited to welcome our teachers back. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Moore. Thank you. Mrs. Swinson. Thank you. Mrs. Hilton.
Good morning. Just a few things to share with you this morning. Good to see everyone. I did want to make sure that you noted that the state did approve our reopening plan, with a note that ours was one of the more extensive plans received statewide. Right before this meeting, we received word that the state has also moved our ESSER grant application forward to the finance review. That's item 9.3 on your agenda, and I also provided you with some additional details on that earlier today. A huge thank you to Michelle Kernan and staff and multiple departments that I can't even begin to name because I'll leave one out, who've worked tirelessly to assist with this grant as well as with the reopening work. I also just wanted to share a reflection with you. Our district is a part of a state group called Impact Florida, where we work with other large and very large districts on various projects. We've continued to meet through quarter four and the summer, and I want to let you know that Pasco continues to be viewed as a leader, from our work in distance learning to the creation of My School Online and that type of option for districts to the next steps with reopening. We also hear this as we work with our partners in the Gates and the Schusterman work streams. And I just want to thank you for your support of our efforts to do that and the opportunity to work with those groups. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Hilton. Thank you for all your work on that. Ms. Hetzler-Nettles?
Good Good morning. It's wonderful to see all of you this morning, and I just wanted to give you a little update on middle school and let you know that our leaders are putting the finishing touches on their school-specific reopening plans, and as Mr. Gatt already mentioned, they have thoughtfully worked through every procedure at their site to create very specific plans in helping them protect all of our stakeholders while implementing the district-wide recommendations. They're very excited to welcome new students, and we have events happening either on the 13th or the 19th, both in virtual and some face-to-face fashion. They have also already been engaging parents in virtual parent nights and student forums. And we appreciate your support and ask for all involved to please continue to check their school-specific websites and social media accounts for those school-specific events. With so many things happening virtually and with the staggering of attendees in place for material pickups and device pickups and such, it is very difficult to put out a single message with one day in time. So we do ask that they please continue to stay informed by looking at websites and social media, and they're excited for those virtual and beginning of year activities. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hetzler-Nettles. Mrs. Poe.
I do just have a brief announcement. I know I've been coming to you each week with a list of schools who have qualified as PBIS model schools. And as I mentioned, they do have throughout the month of August to continue to apply for that designation because we do have several schools still waiting to hear back. So we did hear back on one more school, and it's New River Elementary School. So we want to be sure to give that school kudos. They reached the bronze level designation. And again, I hope to bring many more over the next couple of meetings, but wanted to give that shout out to New River at this time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Poe. Dr. Isle.
I don't have anything to say.
Thank you. Dr. Skanga? Okay, thank you. We have no expulsion hearings or recommendations, so we're moving to the consent agenda. Is there any member who would like an item removed? Okay, I'm going to remove, did you want to?
11-1. Yeah, she's already addressed what I had, but if you want
okay.
To.
I'm still going to pull 11-1 and 11-6.
Okay.
So Madam, I need a motion. Thank you.
Madam Chair, I'll move approval then of the consent agenda with the exception of 11.1 and 11.6 and with the addition of addendum for 10.1 and addendum and correction on 10.2.
Okay. Second.
Motion by Altman, second by Crumbly. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Okay, motion carries. So for 11.1, I wanted to thank Mrs. Kuhn because she did address some of these concerns, but I also wanted to ask a couple questions. Do we have any update on the 21st Century Grant as of now?
Good morning. No, we had heard late last week that we might get something, and those usually come in on Friday evening. We did not get anything then, so we had those programs that had been planning to close. They were actually operating on an extension, and so they were able to continue last Friday. We're hopeful to be receiving word soon. What DOE let Mary Gray and her team know is that it would be about 30 days. That was last week, but then we heard that it might be sooner. So we're not quite sure what to expect right now, but we're hopeful that we can move forward with some of those programs.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I am concerned about the families and their increased exposure, and I'm concerned about the employees. And it is disheartening that we have to do this, but I've been very supportive of PLACE. Mrs. Kuhn and I have had discussed this for months, so this wasn't a short, easy decision that was made. In fact, you know, my own son's attended PLACE at four different schools. I'm sick over it, but we have had several conversations, and PLACE just can't continue to operate in the red. Nobody could have known this ahead of time. None of us could have planned for a pandemic. There's been emails of concern about the employees. There are several IA positions that we're hopeful they will apply for, and I think some of them have already been hired, correct?
That's correct.
Thank you. So I'd certainly like to reopen PLACE programs when things get better, and I hope that we can do that. And I know that doesn't necessarily help some families now, but there are transportation options. So I just wanted to make a couple comments about that. Did anybody else have any further comments or questions?
Yeah, I just wanted to weigh in as well. It's very heartbreaking for a lot of the families because they're impacted, and we all understand that. And this is not an easy or quick decision, as Chair Bowen mentioned. And I'm just confident and hopeful that we can, as Mrs. Kuhn said, rebound soon. And I appreciate the big effort you all have made to relocate these employees within a system so that they are taken care of. Thank you.
Mrs. Kuhn, you had mentioned, I think you mentioned in your questions, but I just wanted to clarify, this, we're hoping that this is not permanent, correct?
Correct.
Okay. I just also wanted to make a few comments, if that's okay. I acknowledge the importance of these programs as a former teacher. I've seen firsthand what these programs do and the impact that they have on our students, and so I want to thank Ms. Gray and her team. I acknowledge the importance of these programs and what they mean to our families. This, too, has really weighed heavy on my heart. It breaks my heart, but I want to assure the public and also our staff that we have some options, and we hope that you take advantage of those options. I really hope that once COVID goes away, that the enrollment will go up and that we can open these 11 sites again. And I just wanted to say thank you to all of our staff and in place. I am really, truly grateful for each and every one of you. They were on the front lines during all this. So this was definitely a decision not made lightly. So thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to move. Did you have a comment, Mr. Rowe?
No.
I'm going to move to approve 11.1. Sorry.
Second.
So motion by Bodwin, second by Altman. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. 11.6, thanks for staying up there,
You're
Mrs.
welcome.
Kuhn. I just had a couple questions about the use of facilities. Do the fees include, like, the extra deep cleaning and sanitation of those events, especially at Sun Lake High School and Trinity Elementary, where they're utilizing indoor spaces?
All of our use of facilities right now do include an enhanced cleaning fee, and so that's part of our review process now that when they go to purchasing, when anyone applies to use facilities, purchasing reviews it and then also sends it to the maintenance team. They look at what needs to be done, how many hours would be required, any additional supplies that would be needed, and they look at that and factor that into the fee before they respond back to the applicant. We do have some sites who are using indoor and outdoor, so that's certainly something that's taken into account. And then we also look at timing. So, for example, we have some churches who are using the facility on Sunday. We have place starting in at 6:30 a.m. on Monday morning, so we make sure that we have the timing worked out so we can have those facilities ready to go for Monday morning.
Thank you. That was all the questions I had. Thank you.
Thank you.
So I move to approve 11.6.
Second.
Motion by Bodwin, second by Armstrong. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. We're under miscellaneous action items. 15.1, we already did a motion to take the off-agenda item of 15.1 to reschedule the meeting. So now we need discussion on that item.
So, Madam Chair, I'll move approval of adjusting the meeting time to 9:30 a.m. for that day.
Motion by Altman, second.
I'll second it.
Second by Armstrong.
Yeah.
Okay, discussion?
For the sake of discussion. I think it does need to be pointed out the reason for doing this. It is election day. That, you know, it's not something we're just doing arbitrarily. It does both that when we look at our calendar for next year, we need to do a little bit deeper dive into when these important milestones are going to be held so we can avoid them in the future. The other alternative that was raised was having the meeting like on the 25th of August, which would be after school has opened. And I do feel it's important to have this meeting before we open the schools.
I agree, because I would have entertained a motion to move it to the following week, but you're right, we should meet before school's open in case anything comes up. Superintendent?
Madam Chairman, just a point of clarification. The primary was initially scheduled for August 25th, and so it would not have conflicted with our 18th board meeting, and then the legislature changed the date of the primary to the 18th. So we normally would not have this conflict in the primary. In the general election, we do have a board meeting, and historically we have a board meeting the morning of the general election, but it's not an evening meeting, so there is no conflict there.
Okay, thank you. Any other discussion? Okay, All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion carries. I need a motion and a second to take the off-agenda item 15.2, and that's the REA contract extension.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Altman, second by Harding. And this is, we're voting on taking the off-agenda item. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion carries. Now I need a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendation for 15.2, the contract extension.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Altman, I wasn't sure which one. Second by Harding. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. So we are moving on to individual board member reports. Mrs. Crumbly, would you be all right with going first? I'm just going to follow the order we're sitting.
I don't like being at this end, by the way.
But sure. Note that, Mrs. Facemeyer. Yes. Mix it up next
week.
Time. Thank you.
No, I'm kidding. Whatever. Okay, first of all, I'd like to speak to the folks who showed up today. I do appreciate all of you that came out today and spoke, and I do not take your comments or your feelings or your emotions and your concerns lightly. I do want to know that. And I feel like I have to plead publicly to the governor and the education commissioner that I wish they wouldn't force our school districts through dollars and funding to reopen there when the local virus transmission rate is not what it should be, which currently ours is not. In my perfect world, we would go back on a month-to-month basis and monitor it. It would also be unfair of me not to acknowledge the nearly 66%, according to the superintendent. I didn't realize it was that high still. The 66% of parents who want the traditional brick and mortar setting for their students. And I receive many phone calls and emails from these folks continually as well. And they're concerned about the academic, social, emotional damage to their students that is occurring with distance learning, as well as even more so, I'm concerned about our financially challenged students and they're falling behind. This is another heartbreaking aspect to COVID-19. I would like to point out, just for those who are here today and may not be aware, because I get a lot of questions about, well, why can't you do half in, half out? I mean, you know, 2 days in, 2 days online, and that I've inquired to staff about a number of alternative schedule ideas, and the executive order states clearly that the brick and mortar must occur 5 days a week, each student. So that's the response to that. And that's all I have to say today.
Thank you, Mrs. Crumbly. Mrs. Harding?
There hasn't been much going on in the last week, but I want to thank Ms. Gray and the team for all their hard work with PLACE. I also want to give a shout out. I know we finished our graduation, so the congratulations to the class of 2020 that got to walk last week. Really proud of you. And I also wanted to ask the superintendent follow up to some of my questions, if you could give me a little update on that. You working on that, or the questions that I asked about two board meetings ago, I've yet to receive a response.
We are still working on answers to those and many other questions. We're wading through the pile. Yes, okay. Ma'am.
I just want to make sure, because we need to get that out to staff very, very soon. So those are my only things. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Altman?
Really, the only thing I wanted to say was a follow-up on the Marchman exams. To, in the middle of this, to have over 600, if my math was correct, quickly, and certification tests and exams is outstanding. And I just wanted to compliment you and your entire team on that. And it's another example that education continues, and we're helping prepare people for life. And that was a good word, and I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Altman. Mrs. Armstrong?
Yes. I had the opportunity to be the speaker at Seven Springs Rotary Club and spoke about the different school options that are being offered and the extra measures that are being taken at the schools for the safety of the students and staff. They were very appreciative of the information, because a lot of people, if they don't have children in the schools, they really don't visit our website and visit the our social media, and they really in the dark as to what we were actually doing. So felt that was very worthwhile, and if we do have the opportunity to go out and kind of explain what we are doing at the schools, I think that's a very good thing that if we could do that. Attended Enclote High School graduation, no rain, thank goodness. It was a very nice event. The parents were very proud that, you know, have a chance to see their child walk across the stage and have the photo op, and it kind of put a nice conclusion to the year finally for these seniors, even though there were a lot of students that had already attended, gone out and joined the military, and they recognized those students as well. So it was a very nice event. And then I wanted to thank Vanessa Hilton for the email that you sent out regarding what the ESSER grant money is going to be used for, because I think it's important that we know that money is being used for a lot of different measures for the safety of our students and for help for the teachers. So I'm glad to see that we're putting that money to really good use. That's all.
Thank you. I continue to hear from community members, as do all of you, those people who are here and people who are communicating through Let's Talk and through email and phone calls, you know, with concerns about reopening schools. The majority of the emails are from teachers who are concerned about their safety. I've also heard, though, from teachers and families who are ready and want brick-and-mortar schools open. One parent asked me to share the data that shows Pasco County is still a hotspot with regard to cases of COVID. I also received the most recent data from the health department, and it shows that we are trending down. It is not as low as we would like it to be, though. One of my biggest concerns centers on our secondary teachers and students. I realize that we are following statute, and staff has worked diligently on safety and sanitizing protocols. Each school site is unique. I know our administrators and staff are doing what they can to make adjustments, everything from changing hallway traffic patterns to changing out water fountain spots. There's additional sanitizing practices. They're rearranging rooms and more. However, we cannot ensure social distancing in every secondary classroom. And I know our teachers realize that and our staff, and I'm not 100% sure if all the parents do, so I wanted to make sure I made that clear. We can't guarantee it in every classroom. We just can't. However, I was encouraged last night to see classrooms at Pineview Middle School and how they were able to set them up in a way that maximized the space between students. I want to thank Mrs. Warren, her staff, teachers, and the families who volunteered to go into that school for the simulation. They have cleared the room of extra furniture, extra tables, extra filing cabinets, so they could spread out the desks more. It was a little disheartening to see people were criticizing them for that on social media. I called over there this morning, and they're going to work on their smallest room next to show what they are able to do in there. Again, it is not perfect, and it is different at every school, but people are trying really hard to do what they can with what they have. So I will follow up with staff regarding the speaker who spoke about the air conditioning at Wiregrass Ranch High School. I'll follow up on that. I also wanted to note that if at some point we were to go remote, I want the public to know that our staff has been exploring multiple options. None are guaranteed, but we have been looking into ways to support families with childcare and tutoring to be able to continue to feed our students and families and keep our employees working. We are in this together. We are all committed to our students, families, teachers, staff, and community. Is there any other new business from staff?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Attorney Alfonso.
So, Madam Chair, I do.
I have an item that I just actually became aware of that I wanted to bring to the board's attention, and I want to actually fall on our sword. I have received a number of general topics, requests for speakers to speak during that time of the meeting, and two requests are from speakers who have spoken before, Mr. Connolly among them. So I looked at the board policy regarding that, and it appears that the policy is limiting. Says that it would only accept three. It says specifically statements made by the members of the public shall be limited to 3 minutes in duration once per meeting. And I bring that up because in the script that I read, I usually say each speaker will have 3 minutes during this segment of the agenda. So there is an inconsistency in what I read as a script and what the policy says. So I just want to bring that to the board's attention. The policy also, the bylaw specifically says the time may be extended by the presiding officer as warranted under the circumstances. So I wanted some direction from the board chair or the board to just say, I certainly will direct or refine my script to reflect the policy, and then that does affect two of the three speakers who have submitted cards for the next segment of the agenda.
Well, I would say for tonight, because of the inconsistency, we go ahead and let them speak unless anybody opposes that.
Okay. Just clarify for next meeting.
Yeah.
I will fix it for the next meeting, and with that, I have no other matters at this time to discuss with the board, so thank you.
Okay, thank you.